It is fine, we understand that. So you can take the KMON test if suppose there is a gap to like, my, you know, many days gaps are there between two exams, then you can take that time the KMON test. But then we are not able to find any other appropriate time, because if we prepone the exam, then probably syllabus will not get over, and we can't postpone because your school exams are there, right? So that's the reason why we have to start from 31st of January. And 31st of January, many of you are writing KVPI also, right? So I think almost all of you are writing KVPI, right? So all the best for that also. So probably you'll not be able to take the 31st KMON test as well. That also you can take later. We are flexible this time round. Don't worry much about the scheduled time of the KMON test and day. You can take it as per whenever you get time, but do take it, okay? This is the full class 11 syllabus test. All right, guys, so we can start now. Initially I thought that I'll be doing problem solving on rigid body dynamics, but then later I realized that there is a small chunk of the chapter which we have to cover, that is Beats and Doppler's effect. So that will take around 2 hours to complete itself. So I thought that remaining 1 hour, rather than starting something new, entire class, let us do waves only. We'll be completing the leftover portion and we'll do some problem practice from the same chapter, waves. Okay. And whatever classes are there, we can do some problem practice on, let's say, like chapters like rigid body or fluids. Okay. All right. So without wasting any more time, let me start. Today, we'll start with a topic called Beats. Okay. Write down Beats. So when you hear Beats, what comes in your mind? Musical beats. Drums. Okay. Okay. Let me tell you, this is not that Beats which you think. All right. This is the outcome. I'll show you exactly how you can hear the beats which I'm talking about. First, all of you write down, beats is the outcome of superposition of two waves having different frequencies. Okay, till now we were superposing waves. When they were traveling the same direction, they were giving another traveling wave. When two waves are traveling in opposite direction, they were creating standing wave, right? And both the cases, the frequencies of both the waves were same, okay? But this is the first time when frequency we are varying, and this will result in beats. So let me just show you exactly how it sounds like when you hear beats. See, all of you, listen to this.
Phenomenon of beats. This phenomenon is used.
Can you hear this? Are you able to hear it? Okay, great. So all of you, listen to it carefully.
To tune musical instruments in an orchestra, for example, the oboe will give an A. And then all the other instruments in the orchestra will tune their instrument to the oboe. tuning is most effective if the beats, if you can actually hear the beats. And to get beats, you need the sound of the reference instrument, say the oboe, and the sound of the instrument being tuned to be roughly the same volume. And you get a loud, soft pattern from the combined effects of the two frequencies being played simultaneously, the oboe and the violin, or the oboe and the French horn, or whatever. So I'm going to demonstrate that with these tuning forks. They're supposed to be identical, but they haven't been quite constructed identically. And in order to tune them, actually previous to the demo here, I found the location of this movable piece of weight so that the two tuning forks come out with about the same frequency. So when they're tuned, you can hear a nice steady tone that doesn't vary in loudness. But when you vary the frequency,
right now when he is beating both the tuning forks, the frequency from both are same. So same frequency sound waves were superposing. Now he is now changing the frequency of one of the tuning forks. So now see what will happen.
Frequency of one of them. Even
he just moved one part of structure upward. So structures, this oral structure changed. So its natural frequency also changed. So automatically the frequency that will come out from tuning fork also changes.
A little bit, then you get the following phenomena. Can you hear a wah, 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 wah? Do it again. Wah, 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 wah. The farther these are from being tuned, the faster the wah, wah pattern is. So these are even further out of tune. What I'm doing by moving this weight is lowering the frequency of this tuning fork, and the other one is staying the same. And you should be able to hear wah, 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 really fast. And
so you can see that now you understand what is beats. Is it clear? Okay. So what is the use of that? What is the use of that in, have you seen when, let's say, someone comes to perform in the stage, initially they try to tune their musical instruments. Let's say a drummer will come and along with it, there will be some other musical instruments will be there. So they will spend 5-10 minutes just tuning their musical instruments. Have you seen that? Have you observed that? Right. So when they do that, they're trying to eliminate the beats. Otherwise, you'll not hear a very nice sound. The different frequencies will come from different musical instruments. They will superpose and you'll not get a comforting music. So they will try to eliminate the beats initially for first 5-10 minutes. That is what they do when they say they are tuning the musical instruments. Okay. Fine, so this is the use of it, that it is something which is unwanted. You want to eliminate it, okay? There is no use of it. You want to eliminate it, actually. All right. So now this is what it is. Now let us see mathematically how we can analyze it, right? In our textbook, in our NCERT textbook, they have taken two waves, which are cosine waves for some reason. Okay, they should have taken sine wave itself, but since they have taken cos wave, I'm also taking cos, and cos and sine both are same only, just pi by 2 phase difference is there. So this is one of the wave, and second wave is, let's say, a cos kx minus omega 2t. These are the two waves having same amplitude, but their frequencies are different. Okay. Now I am superposing these two waves. All right. Now it is my coordinate system that we can pick, we can choose origin. All right. So what I'm doing is that I am superposing both waves at origin. So what I'll get y1 plus y2. So y is equal to y1 plus y2. When I superpose at origin, x is equal to 0. So it will be a cos of omega 1t plus a cos of omega 2t. Cos of minus theta is cos theta. All of you able to understand this? Right, this is a superposition. Now, when you add them up, you'll get 2a cos of omega 1 plus omega 2 by 2 into t multiplied by cos of omega 1 minus omega 2 by 2 into t. Okay, now all of you can see that you'll get a function like this, which has two time functions. What I mean is that it has multiplication of this with this. Okay, both are periodic functions, right? Both are cosine functions, all right? Now, which one is oscillating faster? Can you tell me which one is having higher frequency? The red one or the orange one? All of you, which one is oscillating faster? The red one or the orange one? The red one, of course, it has higher frequency, right? Omega 1 plus omega 2 by 2 into t. Okay, now if frequencies are high, all right, if frequencies are high, then we'll not be able to hear the fluctuations. Fine. For example, when I'm talking to you, all right, I have certain frequency of my voice, right? But then you're not able to hear that fluctuation, the actual frequency. Let's say I am talking to you in a frequency of, I'm not sure, but maybe let's say 100 hertz. So you're not able to hear my voice going up and down 100 times in 1 second, right? So if frequency is high, you'll not be able to hear the fluctuation, okay? So basically, although fluctuation is happening because of the red one also, but we as humans, humans won't be able to hear the fluctuation of, write down, fluctuations of cos of omega 1 plus omega 2 by 2 into t, simply because it is too rapid. It's very, very fast. Okay. But that second term is fluctuating very slowly. Because even if, let's say, omega 1 is very high, omega 2 is also very high. And if omega 1 and omega 2 are little closer to each other, when you subtract it, it becomes very less. Okay. So this one we can hear. Okay. So this one we can hear as the frequency is supposedly less. Frequency is much lesser. Okay. Right. And the function which you have here is a multiplication of these two with 2a. Okay. So let me just show you graphically how does it look like. So y is equal to 2a cos of omega 1 plus omega 2 by 2 into t and cos of this. Okay, now since it is multiplication of these two functions, if any of them becomes 0, the y will become 0. All right, so it is difficult to plot this mathematically. So I'll just show you how does it look like, then it will make more sense to you. See, this is how it is. Don't copy right now. I'm drawing an envelope and then this is what, this is the plot for the above function. Okay, so the rapidly, you can see there are two frequencies. One frequency is that rapid fluctuation. It comes down and comes up quickly. And second fluctuation is the fluctuation of the amplitude. You can see overall there is an envelope. This is the fluctuation which I am talking about. You will be able to hear the fluctuation that is captured on the dotted line. Okay, this fluctuation is because of this. And that blue one, which is rapid fluctuation, is because of this term. Okay, we as humans will not be able to hear this blue fluctuation. We will feel as if the fluctuation is this only, the white one. Okay, we'll be able to hear only this. Okay, so our ears will filter out. Now we are talking about something we hear only, so we will ignore this term. So beat frequency is related to what we as humans can hear. So if I talk about beat frequency, which we can hear this one, right? Cos of omega 1 minus omega 2 by 2 into t. So what is the frequency of this term, everyone? What is the omega for that term? It is omega 1 minus omega 2 by 2. All of you, fine, right? This is the omega for this term, which we are able to hear. Okay, so now one more thing you need to understand is that when fluctuation happens like this, this is one complete wavelength. Okay, in one complete wavelength, once it goes to this extreme, and then again it goes to that extreme. Okay, this is plus A, this is minus A. If I'm talking about what I can hear, I will be able to hear plus A and minus A exactly the same way. Because I'm not hearing amplitude, I'm hearing intensity, and intensity is proportional to amplitude square. Do you all understand that in one cycle, I'll be able to hear two loudness, plus A and minus A? Type in quickly. See, I'm telling you things in detail so that you better understand. Otherwise in book, it is not in so much detail. Let me know if it is clear. Type in quickly. Fine. So if the frequency of this function is omega 1 minus omega 2 by 2, the beat frequency, the frequency with which I'll hear the loudness, will be 2 times of that. It'll be 2 times of omega 1 minus omega 2 by 2. Okay. I didn't understand hearing the intensity part. See, what we hear is energy, okay? Some sort of energy goes in our ears and that will convert into electrical signal and that goes in our brain, okay? So the energy is proportional to amplitude square, okay? So whether the fluctuation is above or below, for energy, it doesn't matter. When let's say, for example, the some spring is there, half kx square, the energy remains half kx square, whether x is plus 2 or minus 2. Okay, it will be same. Similarly, when the oscillation is happening, the energy when you are at plus A or minus A will be same. That is what I am saying. You will hear two loudness in one cycle. Clear, Aditya? So beat frequency is this. So in our textbook, they have written directly. All right. In our textbook, they have written directly that this is the beat frequency. Acha, why not others? You'll be able to hear this also. Why not? But beat frequency is defined. It is defined as how frequently you hear the loudness. Loudness will be distinct. Getting it? For loudness will come like that and then go down and then again will come. So you will see that, okay, what is the difference between two loudness? Okay. Fine. So this is the angular beat frequency. The actual beat frequency will be equal to F1 minus F2. So if you are interested in only problem solving, then beat frequency of two sources having frequency F1 and F2 is F1 minus F2. Pretty simple. Okay. To solve problem, you just need to remember that. Okay. Now, this is clear, I suppose, beat frequency. So now tell me one thing, that if frequency of one, the frequency of first source is 10 Hertz, okay, and you are getting a beat frequency, you're getting a beat frequency of second source of 4 Hertz, then F2 should be what? All of you, what should be the value of F2 to get a beat frequency of 4 Hertz? Okay, good, Hariharan. It can be 14, right? F2 can be 14 as well as 6. All right. The difference should be equal to 4. Pretty simple. All right. So this is how the problems from this chapter, from this topic would be. In fact, we'll see there are certain varieties where you will club with the other topics to with this concept. Okay, but then standalone concept, if there is a question, it will look like this only. Just find a difference and you'll get a beat frequency. Okay. Fine, guys. So we are now moving towards the last topic of this chapter and probably the most important one, because I have seen that if there is a question from this chapter, there is a very high chance that it will come from this topic that we are going to discuss now. And the reason for it probably would be that you can mix mechanics with it. So the variety become a bit larger, okay? So the name of the topic is Doppler's effect. Do you know anything about Doppler's effect already? Ever heard of it? No one? No one has ever heard of it? Red shift. Okay, good. What else? Anybody else? Frequency is not absolute. Very good. All right. So, have you ever wondered how radar works? How sonar works? It works under this principle. So first I will write down what it is. Correct, Shashwat. I mean, not 100% correct, but then yes, that is what it is. Write down. It is the apparent It is apparent, it appears. It's not actual, but it appears. Okay. Apparent change, change of frequency. Because of the movement of the source and or observer. Observer could be a detector. It need not be a living being. It can be just a machine component which is detecting something. Okay. Source is the source of sound or source of frequency. All right. So Doppler's effect tells us that, you know, if there is a movement of something which is generating sound or something which is capturing the sound, then the frequency will change. All right. And there is a mathematical relation to how much frequency will change for how much movement or for what velocity, how much frequency will change. And that is one of the very, very interesting discovery because, you know, right down there is an equation or relation between velocities of source and observer with change in frequency. Okay. So that is how radar works. Radar will just, what radar will do, it will try to capture the sound coming from the aircraft, or radar will throw away its own vibration in the air. It will hit the aircraft and then come towards it. All right. And then it will calculate how much frequency has been changed. And because of that frequency change, it will estimate where the aircraft is first, and second, with what velocity the aircraft is moving in its direction. Fine. Dolphin also do that to detect. I'm not 100% sure about dolphins, but then yes, I have heard that they use the ultrasonic sound. Okay. So this is what it is, guys, that it is the first practical thing in the chapter. Okay. Rest all were just theory part of it. Rest all as in what is superposition, what is beats, what is sound, what is the velocity of sound. All those were introduction. They were not, let's say, something which is directly useful. It is like ABCD of what is waves. Now we are getting into that. Okay, fine. Now you know the basics of the waves. Let us see how we can use it. And Doppler's effect is one such example wherein you can use the property of the waves. Which property? The apparent change in the frequency. All right. So we are going to derive a relation between how fast the source or observer should move to create a given amount of change in frequency. All right. And then we'll see some numericals out of it. Right. And so there will be two cases. Case number one, when source is moving, observer is at rest. Case number two, source is at rest, observer is moving. Then you'll say case number three, both are moving. If both are moving, we'll club case one and case two together and directly write the expression. Okay. So we'll split the thing into these two. Sir, but why does frequency change? Yeah, Aditya, we are trying to derive it. So you will know why it changed, how it changed, because we are going to see entire derivation only. Okay. What is frequency? Frequency is how many times you see the crests in a second, or how many times you see the troughs in a second. That changes. Okay, suppose wave is coming towards you like that, and you are also moving towards a wave. Suppose you are stationary, then waves, crests will hit you after, let's say, 2 seconds. Two crests will hit you in 2 seconds. But if you are also moving against the wave, then wave crests will hit you in less than 2 seconds. Don't you think so? So you'll feel as if frequency is less. Understood? Okay, case number one is the source is moving. Hold on, Aditya, we are going to derive it. Source is moving and observer is stationary. All right, since asking again and again, I'll just quickly talk about it once. Suppose this is a wave, okay? This is coming towards you, fine? This is coming towards you, you are stationary, all right? These two crests will come and hit your ears in, let's say, in some time, okay? Now, you are stationary right now, then you also start moving. If you also start moving in this direction, when you are stationary, if these two crests, one and two, they're hitting you in 2 seconds, then you are moving towards the wave. So now these two crests will hit you sooner or later. Will they hit you in less than 2 seconds or more than 2 seconds? What do you think? If you also start moving towards the wave. Did you get my question? Less than 2 seconds. So you are observing the two peaks of the wave in less than 2 seconds. But its time period is 2 seconds. You are observing lesser time period. So frequency is more. Understood? But actually frequency is not more. Because of your movement, it appears as if frequency is more. All right? But who cares whether it is appearing or it is the actual one? All right? What appears is more important than what actually it is, because your detector will detect what appears to it. Fine. So let's draw this one line. And here is another line. All of you be very alert here, because this is the derivation from your textbook, NCERT textbook, and this derivation, I have seen that people find it tricky, okay? So this is, let's say, source. This is observer, okay? Observer is stationary. This line represents observer. It is stationary, it is not moving. But the source has a velocity of Vs, okay? And speed of sound is C, all right? Speed of sound is C. This distance between source and the observer is L. This distance is L. C is the velocity of sound, okay? So let us say that after every time period T naught is the time period with which I am throwing pulses from here. Okay. Now you will argue that we should be throwing a wave. Okay. Whether I throw a wave or a pulse doesn't matter. If time period is T naught, after every time period T naught, if I'm throwing a pulse, it is a wave only with time period of T naught. Okay, just for the simplicity, I'm taking that way. Okay, so what I'm doing is I'm throwing the pulses after every time T naught. I am trying to find out after what is the time period between which I get the two pulses here. Do you understand this? All of you type in. This understanding, this thing is important before I start the derivation. T naught, let's say I am throwing after every 5 seconds, I am throwing pulses from the source. After every 5 seconds, I am throwing pulses from the source. So my time period is 5 seconds. Suppose I am receiving pulses after every 4 seconds. So as an observer, my time period is 4 seconds. Okay. So I am trying to relate what is the time period with which I am throwing the pulses with whatever is the time period I am receiving the pulses. Getting it? Everyone type in. I don't want to start the derivation before you guys understand this basic first. Type in quick. Himanshu, Karthik, Nikhil, Nishan, Pooja, Rehan, Vaibhav, Swaraj, Shreyas. Is it all clear? What is the length here? Length is the distance between source and observer. Okay. Again, I am repeating myself. I am throwing disturbance from the source after every 2 seconds, let's say. After every 2 seconds, I am throwing something from this side. I want to see after what time interval I am catching that disturbance from the source side. Okay, so with whatever time interval I am catching it, that is my time period. Whatever time period source is throwing the pulses, that is a source's time period. And frequency is 1 by time period only. All right, so it is better to understand the time period. Frequency will just be inverse of that. Okay, fine, enough of Gyan now. So one pulse is thrown from here. Can you tell me at it is thrown right now at, let's say, time right now is zero. At t equal to 0 seconds, a pulse is thrown from here. When it reaches here, what will be the time? Everyone, what is the time when the pulse reaches there? With what velocity pulse is traveling? With what velocity pulse is traveling? Everyone. It's traveling with speed of sound. This C. C is given to you. So something is traveling with C velocity. Distance is L. So how much time it will take? How much time? Don't you think it is L by C? L by C only? But the source is also moving with Vs. Will that affect? Will the velocity of source affect the velocity of sound? What do you think? Everyone. Source is moving and throwing the pulses. So will the velocity of pulse, correct, velocity will depend only on the medium. It doesn't depend on it. Okay, fine. Now I am throwing the next pulse. T1 is, what is T1? T0. After every T0 time period, I am throwing pulses. So at what time I will receive the second pulse here? Find out. At what time I'll receive the second pulse as an observer? Everyone, when I'm throwing the second pulse, don't you think that observer will move little bit? Sorry, the source will move little bit. This distance will be what? This. This distance will be Vs into T naught. Okay. So now tell me what time it will take. Everyone, what is the distance between the source and observer now? Source and observer, the distance is L minus Vt. L minus Vs T naught divided by C. Is that the answer? Is that the answer? Correct. Plus T naught. No L by C, plus T naught. It's not that when pulse, the first pulse, when first pulse reaches here, second pulse is right behind it. It's not that the second pulse has started when first pulse has reached. Are you getting it? All of you? Okay, so this is T1. Now let's do one more exercise. The third pulse. Third pulse, what is the time here? Tell me. What is the time there? Two T naught, right? After every T naught, I'm throwing pulses from there. So why there is confusion there? Are you getting it, everyone? Keep it straight, simple. Are you getting, see, the first pulse at t equal to zero, second pulse at t equal to t naught, third pulse at t equal to two t naught. Okay, I'm throwing pulses after every t seconds, all right? So now tell me, what is the time here when the third pulse reaches? All of you. What's the time there? It's more of kinematics question, right? Do it yourself. It is very easy for me to tell you directly. But if you do it yourself, you will remember. Okay, Hariharan got it. Others? Okay, so now what is the distance between source and observer? After 2t naught, the distance is L minus 2vs t naught. It will further move forward by 2vs t naught, c plus 2t naught. Type in, is everybody able to understand this? The derivation is almost over now. Just go through it once, ask me the doubts. From source, see, source is continuously throwing out the pulses, one after the other, at t equal to zero, at t equal to t naught, at t equal to two t naught. Observer is receiving this at L by C, this one at L minus Vs t naught by C plus t naught, and this one at that time. That is what we did. Time period have to be same as What do you mean? No. Time period is difference between the two time intervals. T1 and T0, what is the difference? That is the time period. T2 and T1, what is the difference? That is the time period. Getting it? Time difference between two pulses is the time period. All of you understand? Type in quick. Okay, great. So can you tell me what is the, let me copy this on the other page. So now that we have here. So now time period from the source side is T0. That is very clear. Time period, the new time period is T1 minus T0 or T2 minus T1. And you can see that both are same only. Both are same. So T1 minus T0 is how much? T1 minus T0 is not, oh, wait. This I should put it as dash. This is T0 dash T1. This is different from that. Okay. All right. So basically this time minus that time is what I'm doing. Okay. So L minus VS T0 by C plus T0 minus L by C. Okay. This is equal to T0 minus VS T0 by C, or it'll be C minus VS by C times T0. This is the new time period. This is what we will observe as an observer. Okay. So frequency will be what? The modified frequency will be 1 by T1 dash. This is your modified frequency. It will be inverse of this red bracket C divided by C minus VS into 1 by T0, which is N0. Okay. So you can see that the frequency has been changed. The frequency which was N0 has become C divided by C minus VS into N0. So frequency has increased or decreased, all of you? It has increased or decreased? Everyone? Decreased. How it is decreased? C divided by C minus VS into N0 is greater than N0 or less than N0? It's greater than N0. Denominator is lesser than numerator. Okay. Right? It is increased. So basically, if the source moves towards observer, frequency increases. And if source moves away from the observer, frequency decreases. So what we have derived, we had assumed that the source is moving towards the observer. Okay. Now, if it is supposed moving away from the observer, then how the formula will change? N is equal to, right now, this is the formula wherein the source is coming towards the observer. If source is going away from the observer, the formula will change to what? Correct. It will become C divided by C plus Vs times N naught. Okay. So all you have to do is to remember these two basic things. You will not confuse with when to take plus, when to take minus, because plus minus will come again when observer moves, source is stationary. All right. So if you remember the thumb rule that when source moves towards the observer, frequency should increase. And when observer moves towards the source, then also frequency should increase. So that way it will become easier for you to remember things. Otherwise, frequency, you can write the formula as C plus minus velocity of the source into N naught. Okay. So this is the condition wherein the source is moving, but observer is at rest. Now let us see the derivation of source is at rest, but observer is moving. Okay. So you have seen the first derivation in which the source is moving, observer is at rest. Exactly the same way we are going to derive the second one. So most of it, I want you to do it. I'll just give you hints. Okay. So this line represent the source. So let me first write down the heading. Case number two. Source at rest, observer moving. What happened? Here we release sound to be release sound. Relative speed of the sound is to be no. Speed of the sound relative to what? Relative to what? Observer, no. Speed of the sound is the absolute speed. Okay. Observer was at rest initially, isn't it? Source was moving. Observer was not moving. Now we are considering source is at rest and observer is moving. Second case, why are you talking about second case? I haven't even started. When I ask you, then you tell. Let us start. You derive it completely, but let me first tell you the scenario. Okay. This is the source. This is the observer. Very similar scenario. The distance between them is L naught. Okay. Speed of the sound is C and observer is moving with VO. VO. Okay. Speed of sound is C. Okay. Now, very, very similarly, we'll be doing it. I am throwing away first pulse from here at T naught equal to, let's keep it at T1, T2. That will be better. My first pulse goes at T1 equal to zero time. At what time I'll receive here? T1 dash will be what? When I receive it. What is the time on my watch? All of you. Observer is moving. Yes, observer is moving with V naught. The pulse is moving with speed C. pulse is trying to come with a speed of c, and observer is moving with v naught. Okay, so what is the velocity of approach for the sound towards the observer? What is the velocity of approach? C minus v naught. Okay, distance is l naught. So time when it reaches here is l naught divided by c minus v naught. Clear? Now I am throwing second pulse from here. My time is t naught, time period. So when I receive the second pulse, what will be the time on my watch? Don't be in a hurry. Do it accurately, that is more important. Remember, observer is moving, okay? By the time the second pulse has been thrown, what will be the distance between source and observer when the second pulse is about to be thrown? Distance between source and observer will become L naught plus V naught T naught. If you wait till t naught, observer will travel a distance of v naught t naught, right? It is moving. So now the sound has to travel a distance of l naught plus v naught t naught, that divided by c minus v naught, okay, plus t naught time, which is already gone. Is it clear to everyone? All of you, L naught plus V naught T naught is the distance. Okay, great. Now the third pulse, let's do one more time. Third pulse is thrown at 2 T naught. Remember, they are not thrown after first pulse is reached. Second pulse is not thrown after first pulse is reached. All three pulses are in the air only. Okay. So this is thrown at t equal to 0, this is thrown at t naught, this is thrown at 2 t naught, like that it is. Okay, so when the third pulse is received, what is the time on my watch? Everyone. It's okay if you don't get it correct. Even when I was a student, I also did not get it when I was at your age. But try it. You may have got it wrong. Distance will become L naught plus 2 V naught T naught now. In time 2 T naught, the observer will travel V naught into 2 T naught. Okay. That divided by C minus V naught plus 2 T naught. Okay. So derivation is over. Now let's just accumulate whatever we have. So new time period T dash will be equal to T2 dash minus t1 dash or t3 dash minus t2 dash, both will be equal only. So better to subtract T2 dash minus T1 dash, be easier that way. So T2 dash minus T1 dash, L0 plus V0 T0 divided by C minus V0 plus T0 minus this. It will become what? It will, okay, this thing is gone. So it will be V0 T0 divided by C minus V0 plus T0. Okay. So this will become C T0 divided by C minus V0. New time period. C T0 divided by C minus V0. Understood? So the new frequency, which is 1 by T new time period, is equal to C minus velocity of observer divided by C into 1 by T naught. 1 by T naught is the original frequency. So C minus V naught divided by C times N naught. Okay. So frequency has increased or decreased? It has increased or decreased? It has decreased. Why? Because the observer is going away. All right. So when observer goes away from source, frequency decreases. And when observer comes near to the source, frequency increases. So when it comes near, it will become C plus V naught. Okay. So the frequency is C plus minus V naught divided by C times N naught. Got it? So these are the two things. When source is moving, observer stationary. When observer is moving, source stationary. Now case number three, when both are moving, we'll not do any derivation, we'll directly write it, okay? Case number three, both source and observer moves. Then the frequency, I'll club both of them. It'll be C plus minus VO divided by C minus plus VS into N naught. Okay. Again, I'm telling you, if source comes near the observer, it will be C minus VS because frequency has to increase and it is in the denominator. Okay. When observer comes close to the source, then it will be C plus VO because observer velocity is in the numerator and it has to increase. All right. So do all of you understand this? All of you? Is it clear to everyone? This is the most important part of the chapter. Okay. You can afford to still be light on the other parts, but this part, if you ignore, it will become very, very difficult. This chapter, as in 70% of numerical will be on this topic itself. Anyone has any doubts? Quickly type in. No doubts? Okay. Fine. So these are the few straightforward things which are written in the books. Okay. Now I'm going to tell you a few things that I have seen in the numericals, how they make the numericals, what are the sum, important things which you should keep in your mind while solving numericals. Otherwise, it will become very tricky. All right. So here are a few points to remember. Very, very important, these points. Usually people make a lot of mistakes in numerical and then they learn these points. But I'm giving you these things before you even solve numericals. Okay, the first one is the velocity of source and observer are taken along the line joining source and observer. It could be a point only, source and observer. What does it mean? We need to take components. We may need to take component of velocity along the line joining. You have to take components of velocity that will go in the formula. If source is moving like this and observer is here, this velocity will not have any impact in the Doppler's effect. Okay, the velocity should be along the line joining the source and the observer. If it is not, take a component along the line joining. Second, if reflection happens, then we have to solve the situation. Solve is not correct word. We need to analyze the situation in two stages. Okay, stage number one, what is the stage number one? The wall is observer. Okay, so as an observer, wall will get a frequency that may not be equal to the original frequency because wall might be moving. It might happen that wall is sliding or the source itself is moving. Okay. So wall will get a frequency as an observer. Then stage number two, wall will send back same frequency as source. Okay, same frequency, which frequency? Stage one's frequency. Whatever frequency the wall has observed as an observer, the wall will reflect the same frequency, but now wall is a source. Okay, if wall is a source, you know velocity of source comes where? If wall is observer, you know velocity of observer comes in the numerator. Okay. So this thing is very important. I've seen many mistakes here. Third, okay. If anyone have any doubt, you can type in. You don't need to wait for me to complete it and then you type it. If wind is blowing with velocity of wind VW, okay, it sends back the same frequency it apparently receives. Yes, that's what I mean. Whatever wall receives as a source, as a source. Suppose wall is a source. Forget about that. It is a wall. It is a source. Not source. Sorry. Forget the fact that it is a wall. Assume it is an observer. Wall is an observer, let's say. So the original frequency is 400. Okay. Let's say wall as an observer feel it to be 410. So observe as an observer, wall has observed 410, but real frequency is 400. So which frequency wall will reflect as an source? As a source, what frequency wall will reflect? 400 or 410? Everyone. Original frequency is 400. This is original. Wall as a source feels as if 410 is coming as an observer. So which one wall will reflect, 400 or 410? That is what my question is. Type in. Again, I'm repeating. Stage number one, wall is an observer. Okay. As an observer, wall will feel that 410 is coming towards itself, but original frequency is 400. So when you go to stage number two, wall has to act like an source. So when it acts like a source, it will reflect back 400 or 410. All of you, type in. Don't type in two times. Okay. Oh, you want me to take your name? Then only you'll type in. Pranav, Raghuram, Rehan, Rohit, Swaraj, Vaibhav. I've taken six names. Type in. Rishabh Patel. Can you hear me? Rishabh? Okay, so the answer is 410. Look at what is written. Stage number one, wall is an observer. Wall is an observer. So as an observer, wall will not get the original frequency. Wall will get from the formula what you get. C plus V naught divided by C plus minus Vs into N naught. Okay. So original frequency might be 400. But as an observer, wall is getting 410. So wall will give out 410 only. But now wall will become source in stage number two. Okay. So be very clear about it. All right. Point number three is if wind is blowing with VW, then what will happen? What will be the change? What do you think? What change will happen? Correct. The speed of sound will become C plus VW or C minus VW, depending on if it supports or opposes. Okay. Speed of the sound is C only. Okay. But it is like, you know, it's like, suppose there is a structure here, let's say in my hand, there's an insect which is moving on this. Okay, with a small velocity, I take this structure and I move it. So the speed of the insect has increased or not? Insect might be moving with some velocity, 2 meters per second, But I have been moving this with 5 meters per second. So velocity of insect becomes 2 + 5, 7, because it is also moving. Similarly, inside the air, the speed is c only, but air is also moving. Along with sound, air is moving. So the air's velocity gets added or subtracted. Understood? Is it clear to everyone? Okay. Now, the fourth point is just a point of caution that sometimes source and observer are same. It's quite natural. I am hearing my own sound. So I am source as well as observer. And more so ever in the online classes, I hear myself only. Okay. So one example could be that I am, let's say, on a car and I'm moving towards a wall and I blow the horn. Okay. When I blow the horn, the sound goes, reflects from the wall, come towards me and I hear it. So that is what the car along with me is a source of the sound also. And after it get reflected from the wall and reaches my ears, I become the observer also. Okay. So you have to be very flexible in the thinking. Okay. Don't be in a rigid mindset that, okay, this is a formula. I'll substitute this, 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 and that. I'll get the answer. No, it will never happen like that in computer exams. Okay. You have to be open-minded when you think about the equations. All right. So let's take, based on all these points to note, let's take some numericals. Okay. If a solid medium is moving, we can apply the same rule. Yeah, anything. Okay, so here is a small question. You have a plane over here. There is a wall. Okay, this is you. You are creating a sound of frequency N0. All right. Speed of the sound is C. And you are moving with velocity V. Okay. You're moving with velocity V. So you have to tell me, when the sound gets reflected from the wall, it's a stationary wall. When the sound gets reflected from it, what frequency of sound you will feel? Everyone, what is the frequency of sound you will feel? After reflection, what is the frequency of sound? I'll just write down the formula. You might have written yourself though. As a source, we have to do it in two stages. Wall is first an observer and then it is a source. So as an observer, what is the frequency the wall will hear? Can you type in? As an observer, frequency heard by the wall. Everyone type in, don't worry about being right or wrong. If you're right, not a big deal. If you're wrong, then also not a big deal. But if you don't say anything, then there is something terribly wrong. As an observer, the wall is observer. This person is source. Everyone type in your answer. What is the frequency heard by the wall? Velocity of the source is V. Velocity of observer is what? What is the velocity of observer? Zero. Wall is at rest. So frequency should increase or decrease? The source is moving towards the observer. Frequency should increase or decrease? Increase. And it is in the denominator. So it will be C minus. Okay. So it will be C divided by C minus Vs into N naught. This is what it will here as an observer. So what frequency wall will reflect back? What is the frequency wall will reflect back? N1 or N0? N1, because this is what it is hearing as an observer. Okay, it will reflect it back. So now the frequency heard by the person as an observer, wall will become source. What it will be? You can answer in terms of N1. Tell me. Okay, Hariharan got it. Others? Aditya got it. Acha, where the velocity V will come now? There is no Vs, there is only V. So now the person is observer. So observer velocity will come in the numerator only, right? it will come in the numerator because that is now observer. And because of the observer's velocity, frequency should increase or decrease. It is coming towards the source. Source is the wall. Frequency should increase, right? It is coming towards. So it will be C plus. Okay, I have written Vs there. There is no Vs. It is V only. C plus V divided by C into N1. This is the answer. That's it. You need to substitute the value of N1 there. So you can write down in terms of N0. It will be C plus V divided by C minus V into N0. Just go through this question once and type in. Is it clear? This is the first question on Doppler's effect. There are many varieties, but if you don't understand the first one itself, it becomes difficult to proceed. All of you, go through it once. Anyone has any doubts, type in. I'll wait for 30 seconds. We had a question on this on Sunday KVPY mock. Yeah, Doppler's effect is there in KVPY. So now you are done with that. Exact same question will never come, Pranav. There'll be some variety. All right. Do you guys, like when you write the KVPY and when you write the mains Kemon test, are you guys seeing there is a difference in the type or the way the questions are asked in KVPY? Big difference? What is the difference? What is the main difference you see? In KVPY, all questions have negative marking. Yeah, of course. In mains also. KVPY, correct. KVPY is more of imagination. Have you seen that? Have you observed that? They want you to think. They want you to visualize more than the mains exam. Okay, mains is more mathematical, you can say, the physics paper. All right, anyways, next question. Should I give you little, slightly different or difficult one, wherein all the concepts will be tested at once? And then we'll take the easy ones later on. Okay. All the concepts will be tested here. Make sure you attempt this. Getting the right or wrong answer does not matter. Again, I'm telling you. Same situation. But there are some changes. Speed of sound is C. You are moving with V. The wind is blowing in this direction. The wind is blowing with VW. The wall is coming towards you with velocity of U. Okay, anything else? And original frequency is a knot with which you are whistling, let's say. You need to tell me the same thing. What frequency I will receive after reflection from the wall? Okay. First, answer me this one, whatever I have written here. Okay, so speed of the sound will be speed of sound. What you will take? What you will take as speed of sound? Instead of C, you'll be writing C plus VW. That is the only change. Okay, so source is moving or observer is moving? Source is moving or observer is moving? Source. Both are moving. Correct. Wall is the observer and the person is the source. Both are moving. And because of whose motion, frequency will increase, and because of whose, frequency will decrease. Both will increase. All of you understand that? Both will increase. Both are coming towards each other. Both source and observer will try to increase the frequency. Contribution from both sides will be to increase. So C plus VW plus velocity of the observer, which is U. Why plus? Because it will increase. Divided by C plus VW, velocity of sound, minus V. Why minus? It will also increase, but it is in the denominator. So that is a minus. It has to be minus to increase it. That into N naught. Anyone has any doubts here? Charan, is it clear? Okay, now comes the final thing. As a observer, person gets the frequency. You can answer in terms of N1. N2 will be equal to what? Yeah, don't type it. In terms of N1, you can type. In terms of N1, what is the value of N2? Now, velocity of sound, you'll take C plus VW or C minus VW. Sound is traveling like this. It is going from, after reflection, it goes from wall toward the person. So it'll be C minus VW. You're going against the wind. Okay. Now, what? C minus VW, what should I write here? Plus V or minus V? Plus V. This is observer now. Person is observer, right? And the wall is source for the second stage. Okay. So now the person's velocity will be in the numerator, and the wall's velocity in the denominator. Okay. And both will try to increase the frequency. They are coming towards each other. C minus VW minus U times N1, where N1 is this. So it becomes a huge expression actually. So from 1 and 2, you will get N2 to be equal to, let me write it down. Meanwhile, please ask any doubts if you have. No doubts? Okay. Have you observed the Doppler's effect on a railway platform? Like when the train is coming with a siren, you will hear the siren with a different note or frequency, and suddenly the quality of sound or the way you are hearing the sound suddenly changes as soon as the train crosses you. You know, a different type of sound comes. If we ask to find standing wavelength, which frequency do we use? Standing wavelength, what do you mean? Standing wave. In Doppler's effect, where is standing wave? Talking about Doppler's effect or something else? Doppler's effect is not superposition. You're confusing. No superposition. It is the same wave which after reflection comes towards you. And whatever you observe, that is what your frequency is. All right. Frequency will be speed of the sound divided by wavelength all the time. That wave equation will be valid. What you observe is your frequency. Okay. All right. Let me see if I have more questions on Dopplers. These are all simple questions. Okay, you have done much more difficult question than this just now. You should be getting the answer. Okay. You know, it helps to draw a diagram like this to represent the scenario. Otherwise, you have to read the question again and again. Once you draw the diagram, you don't need to read the question. Detector is your observer, if you don't know it already. Anyone close to the answer? Okay, Aditya got something. The original frequency will be less than 1950 or more than 1950. What do you think? It should be more, right? Because both source and detector, they are going away. So they will try to decrease the frequency. And this is the decreased frequency, 1950. So actual frequency should be more than this. Okay. So N should be equal to C minus 10 velocity of the observer divided by C plus 10 into N naught. This is equal to 1950, right? So N naught is equal to C plus 10, which is 350, divided by C minus 10, that is 330. Into 1950. How many of you got this? This. Okay, great. So this is what the answer is. Okay. So anybody solved it further? Why are you getting different types of answers? 2250-2070-2069. Is it exact 2100, Pranav? Okay, let me tell you how much it is. Rounded off. 1950-2068. Aritra, you're using calculator? Don't do it. Nowadays, the exams are more calculation intensive. They knowingly give you difficult calculations. Okay, they knowingly give you difficult calculations. If you have, if you see the latest exams. So if you are not habitual of solving or dealing with numbers quickly, then probably you will struggle a lot in the exam. And that is very frustrating. Even though you know how to solve a question, but because of calculations, if you get stuck, it becomes very frustrating, all right? So be good with numbers and practice. All right, next question. This is also straightforward one. There's no hurry. Solve it slowly, get it correctly. This is the third time we are doing something like this, okay? Pranav got something, others? All right, Aditya also. Fine, many of you got the answer. So you might have already known that C minus V, I'm directly writing the expression. This is what we calculated for this scenario, right? this into n naught is equal to n. Okay, so 330 minus V divided by 330 plus V. No, wait. It is plus here, minus there. Into n naught, which is 440, is equal to n, which is 480. Okay. So now I leave the calculation to you. 330 plus V divided by 330 minus V is equal to 12 by 11. Okay. And from here, you'll get the answer. How you solve this actually? You can do componendo dividendo. This divided by, you add here itself, it becomes 660. This is equal to 12 divided by 23. Okay. Now you can do it. Cross multiply. I think some of you are getting V to be equal to how much? 14. Around 14 meter per second. All right. So, sorry. See, so these are the questions on the Doppler's effect. Let's take one more actually. I did not get that kind in the book. I'll just create that thing. There is an aircraft which is moving like this with a velocity of V. This is aircraft. The arrow is aircraft. Here is U. You are running like that. This is your velocity. U. Your height is very small compared to the level the aircraft is moving above from the ground. Okay. The distance of aircraft from the ground, vertical distance is let's take something else. Let's take it as A, and the horizontal distance from U this distance is B. Okay. The aircraft, when it is traveling, it is emitting sound of frequency N naught. All right. Speed of the sound is C. Fine. You need to tell me what frequency you will hear. Find out what frequency you will hear. This is the last question on Doppler's effect. I'm not adding the wind here unnecessarily. But won't we hear multiple frequency? Yes, you will hear multiple frequency. I am interested right now, what is the frequency you are hearing right now? When aircraft is at a distance A vertically and a distance B horizontally. angle will change by the time sound reaches. Only that angle matters when the sound has started from there. When it has reaches, doesn't matter where the aircraft it is. Aircraft might have changed its direction also. It does not matter. While it is emitting, how the aircraft is moving, that matters only. Yeah, you don't need to type. Just let me know you're done. See, I have just made it up, you know, so answer may not look very nice. Okay, Pranav is done. Others? What is the first thing you have to do? Connect the source and observer. Right? So velocities along this line matters, not the absolute velocities. Getting it? So if this is theta, then this angle is also theta. Okay? So aircraft is coming towards the observer with what velocity? Not V. V cos theta. The person is going away from the aircraft, not with U, but U cos theta. Okay. So what is the frequency? It will be C. What should I write here? Who is observer? This is observer. This is source. Whose velocity comes in the numerator? Source or observer? Observer. Now, because of observer, frequency should increase or decrease in this case? Decrease, it is going away. So C minus of U cos theta divided by C. Now, because of the aircraft, frequency should increase or decrease? Frequency should increase or decrease? Everyone, increase. It is coming towards along the line joining, right? So C minus of V cos theta into N naught. This is the answer. And cos theta you can write separately. Cos theta, cos of this angle, right, is B divided by root over A square plus B square. That's it. This is the answer. All right. All of you understood Doppler's effect? Please type in, then we'll take a break. This is the Doppler's effect.